Bye. Hey, welcome back to the Asylum, your refuge in a world gone mad right here on the Big Talker. Chat is open this morning. Welcome back. Been a hell of a week at Cucalorus, so I'm a little, you know, brain drained. Hell of a festival. Lots of people met from all over the country, got to do my thing. And man, that was an absolute blast. I'm not sure how many films were played. I got to see like five. And they were pretty powerful, man. One of them was a documentary on the old TV show Reading Rainbow. It had LeVar Burton and everybody involved, from the music director down to the, you know, producers and everybody involved to make that thing happen. All kinds of incredible stuff, ladies and gentlemen, gotta say. So, if you didn't see it this year, man, you missed out on a lot of good films. Everywhere. And of course, my installation was an absolute riot. Called Visual Sound Walls, literally built the day of. Came off really well, and I am excited for it. And I'm excited to do more next year, in fact. It's going to be so much fun, I promise. So, I was going to, I guess I should, pivot over to some news and see what I can come up with. Because there has to be good stuff in there from the hominids of America, Hominus, Americanus. Let's see here. Arizona teacher and her hubby lose jobs after filming OnlyFans videos in class. She's making the argument they were both paid so little as teachers they had to start a side hustle. They'd probably get a lot more sympathy if they hadn't actually filmed in the classroom. Aside from that, if there's nothing in your employment agreement you can't make some money on the side, and they probably have a pretty good shot at cashing in. Let's see what this is about. Oh, well, I have an ad blocker for a reason, because I'm tired of your pop-up. So that's one story we won't be reading. And we'll just keep going down the list. We will have Bill Moore a little bit later, about 8:30, to discuss all things Brunswick, the Tuesday evening show at 6 p.m., which will resume this week, because I don't have Cucalorus this week. It was absolutely crazy and so much fun. It was. So, yeah, it's still on my brain. Look at this. I was so dead asleep when I fell in bed last night. My phone hasn't even unlocked. It's like, yeah, we're not playing this morning. We just don't want to play. Not at all. Let's see if this doesn't help. Oh, look at that. Already in much better shape than we were. Coffee helps. And you'd be amazed at how... Okay, so most of you folks might know that I am something, or was something, of a Mountain Dew aficionado. And I actually haven't had a Mountain Dew in nearly 3 weeks. I think I have kicked that habit. Come on, computer, do your thing, man. There we go. I want to make sure that everything is ready for my friend Bill when he arrives this morning. Hello. So the computer's giving me a little bit of an issue. It's like slow as it can be. And that's annoying. Because I want things to happen. Not this Windows 10 stuff. Yep. Sure enough, it's broke. So that's one thing I got to fix real quick before I can have a good conversation with my friend Bill. Because it done broke itself, so yeah, there we go. That should do it. We'll see what happens. Yeah. High-tech Volkswagen office chair has a top speed of 12 miles an hour. What the hell is that about? That just doesn't sound right. Coming out of Oddity Central, a team of Volkswagen designers, and engineers developed a high-tech office chair that you can drive at a top speed of 20 kilometers per hour. Most high-tech office chairs are either simply waterproof or stain-proof, or are designed at a higher standard in terms of ergonomics. But Volkswagen's recent take on a high-tech office chair shows just how low the bar sits at the moment. The German car manufacturer designed and built an office chair with a built-in motor and controls, allowing the user to drive it at a respectable top speed of 20 kilometers an hour, which to us white people is 12 miles per hour. And that's just one of the crazy features built into this one-of-a-kind piece of office furniture. Ooh, tell me more, because this just sounds wicked cool. Oh, here's a quote. Let's see. Oh, no. The quote's a moment. The main goal of this unique project was to implement as many features found in a real Volkswagen car into an office chair. And the team did a truly outstanding job. Not only did they manage to put in an actual motor and driving controls, but also a seatbelt. Honk, I guess they mean a horn, built-in speakers, and even tiny rims for the chair wheels. How's that for sexy? The futuristic office chair also comes with 360-degree collision prevention sensors, a backup camera, touchscreen display, headlights built into the armrest. Oh my god. LED party lights, USB charging, a small pocket for storing documents, and the Volkswagen... Oh, they misspelled it. Ha, that's funny. They typed it as a small pocket for storing documents and the WV logo stitched into the headset, like West Virginia logo, not Volkswagen. So somebody needs to check their spelling there. Anyway. Okay, not you. Go away. That's one. That's hilarious. If you're wondering about autonomy, Volkswagen claims that its high-tech office chair comes with a swappable battery that offers a range of around 12 kilometers on a single charge, which means you can't quite roll for an hour on that thing. Maybe. Let's see. But autonomy is like where it can handle being on its own, and I don't see it doing that. But before you reach for your credit card, you should know that Volkswagen has been pretty clear that this was a one-off marketing project designed to highlight all the features that motorists sometimes take for granted. However, the German company did say that its high-tech office chair will be available for test drives at various locations in the near future. That's awesome. Judging by some of the comments on the YouTube making of video, I'd say Volkswagen may want to reconsider its decision not to make the chair commercially available. Some people seem ready to pay big bucks for it. I could see that. Because we got some lazy mofos up in this country, man. Give me an office chair that I can go pick up my own damn lunch in. That's about as American as it gets right there. I mean, the only thing it'd make it better is if it had, like, a little spot for your Cheetos. That'd be awesome. All right. Take two on this silly machine. See if it's behaving now. Still waking up? Aren't we all, really? Yep. Not a morning show like any other morning show, but hey. Where else would you get news from Oddity Central put into your ear holes, avoiding as much of the political silliness? I'm just not good at it. I don't understand it. I mean, all these people, I think, need to go to jail. Every last one of them. If they want to be in office, chances are they should not be there. That's my take. Anybody running for office should be automatically disqualified. We should be able to nominate them from the general public based on their merits and successes of their own making. Not some silly endorsement from... Anyway, I'll probably get fired if I say much more. So I look for more news stories like the 50-year-old man who goes viral for smoking while running marathons coming out of Oddity Central. A Chinese man, for as much as you love or hate the Chinese people or persons, a Chinese man recently went viral on social media after he was photographed lighting up and smoking several tobacco cigarettes while running a marathon. Can you believe that? I can. At this point, I think everyone agrees that smoking tobacco isn't the healthiest thing you can do, but it's one thing to light up in the comfort of your own home or backyard or garage while enjoying a... Where'd it go? A cup of coffee or on a cigarette break at work, and quite another while running a 42-kilometer marathon. So, when photos of a man in his 50s casually smoking while taking part in the... Not going to pronounce it, marathon last week went viral, everyone was curious to know his story. I could see that. Unfortunately, not much is known about the man apart from the fact that he is known as Uncle Chen among fellow runners, who also confirmed his habit of smoking while running. According to anecdotal reports on social media, Uncle Chen has been spotted at other marathons in the last few years, including the Jiemen Marathon, Li Shui Ultra Marathon, and Lhasa Half Marathon. After some photos of the man smoking while running went viral on Weibo, the organizers of this particular marathon in Yandé City also shared his certificate of achievement, which not only proved that he took part in the event, but also that he ran the 42.195 kilometers in a respectable 3 hours, 28 minutes, 45 seconds, ranking 515th out of thousands of runners. That is pretty amazing, I gotta say. All right, I need to make a couple of... Oh, give me something. I guess that's not going to be the one. So we'll do it this way. Yeah, why not? Let's just put this in there. That'll work. That'll work right fine. That'll be just fine right there. Yeah, I think that'll be fine. Even though I can't spell. So do you think you could smoke while running 26 kilometers? I know I've done it, actually. It wasn't running. It was part of the bike trek to Shakertown, ironically, for the Lung Association. Weird. Weird. I thought you were working. Oh, that's not what I wanted. That is not at all what I wanted. That's the one I wanted. And I want to know why I don't see it. That's bothering me. NDI return video close. NDI web deal. And I do not see me. Huh. That's wild. Are we not on the same network? We should be all together now, ladies and gentlemen. So, I tell you what. Well, no, not yet. I still got coffee, so life is good. Yeah. We'll just roll with it the way it is until we get something to work. It looks like we have a guest this morning. I'm going to take a couple of seconds to correct some of this noise on screen. Come on, computer. There we go. Nice. So now, if I've done this right, my friend Bill Moore has joined us. How are you doing this morning, sir?
Good morning to you, sir. Good to see you as always.
Well, it's good to see me in one piece after Cucalorus.
Yeah, I would imagine you were quite busy.
Oh, that was so much fun. I got to see such incredible films this year. Normally, I don't get to because I'm all teched out. But yeah, we pulled off a bit of a miracle. And man, I should have called you and invited you up for a few of these. They were pretty powerful pieces. But I'm guessing all things Brunswick and the Brunswick County people have survived without my presence over the last week.
We managed to hold on by barely our fingertips, but we managed.
Well, then I will bring gloves. So what's on your mind this morning, sir?
Actually, not a whole lot, because it is a Thanksgiving weekend, week coming up. And, you know, I think we should take some time occasionally to just pause from politics if we can and think about the good things that have been in our lives and the reasons that we're here and how fortunate we are to be an American.
And to have turkey.
Yes, especially with the turkey crisis around the country, you know.
Are they getting a little weird? I don't do much shopping. I do for Thanksgiving. I'm going to have a pot pie.
And I know I'm not even touching that line.
And I would say that it's gone from 79 cents per pot pie up to 92 cents per pot pie. So I'm feeling the squeeze.
Well, evidently we've had a turkey illness and a turkey shortage, as we have with everything else. And
well, there's no shortage of turkeys. I don't know where the hell that's coming from.
Well, we killed a million of them. Those are the edible kind, though. Yeah, there are other turkeys that we just kind of wish would go away, but that's the way it is. But prices are just phenomenal for people, and I feel really bad for those people that are struggling. And I was talking to a friend of mine yesterday. My wife was actually talking to him and relayed to me. Here's a woman one of the northern states. She has a job, but she and her children live out of their car because she can't make enough to make ends meet. You know, that's called being poor. You know, and it's getting better. It's getting worse and worse as we go on because inflation, you know, inflation to many people is an inconvenience. You change your budget a little bit and you throw more money at this and whatever else. To a great number of Americans who live paycheck to paycheck, inflation is deadly. And we don't pay attention to that enough.
And it affects the older generation even more so.
Yep. With
a fixed income.
Yeah, many of them are just on Social Security benefits. And, you know, what's fascinating, and I've always, you know, and these numbers are approximate, but the average Social Security person gets about $1,200 to $1,500 a month, yet we spend over $3,000 a year on illegal aliens.
Now,
that's
why we have groups like the Wilmington Motorcycle Club that drove a mini convoy through three counties to bring a little festive food to the elderly. The Port City Wheelers dropped off boxes filled with yams, rice, turkey, and all the trimmings, starting in Parkwood community of Wilmington, and made deliveries to Burgaw, Leland, and Winnebo, covering 110 miles at 9 stops. So that's, you know, there are community groups that are making efforts to help or to, I don't know, bring a little something. But it's almost depressing that we have to go that way.
And it's almost more depressing that there are more and more people that need the help, not less and less. You know, and it's a story for down the road. But unless we start dealing with things that affect the working poor, though, just the average working man who lives paycheck to paycheck, or woman, let me not be a sexist here, change things. You know, there's a reality that, you know, there are too many people under this gas price that's gone forever. The fuel, they're talking jumping one third to doubling, depending where you are, to doubling what you paid last year. Especially if it's heating oil, or you know, if these people cannot afford to make it, I mean, there's something wrong here. But the inflation is killing them, and we're not dealing with it yet. We're looking at it saying, oh, it's only 8%. It's only, you know, it's down from 8.5% to 7.9%. Well, yeah, that's still killing a lot of people, and having to make decisions of, do I feed people? Do I put gas in the car? Do I pay the electric bill? Do I pay the rent? You know, and decisions are made like that on a regular basis. And that's a shame. And we can do better.
I think we can as well. And it shouldn't be near as much of a community burden as it is a systemic repair. If that makes sense.
It does in a way. I'd just like to hear you talk more about that systemic repair.
So when we're doing little things here and there, like the motorcycle troop delivering food, that's sort of a, you know, here, let's get you through the one day Thanksgiving kind of thing. But a systemic repair would be along the lines of making things a little bit more accessible to more people that have these issues, that we shouldn't be relying so much on the charity of, say, religious groups or churches or motorcycle organizations, and have more of an understanding that raising these prices for, you know, record high profits for some of these companies, that we could probably, you know, loosen that need for greed so that things aren't quite as expensive at the bottom end.
You know, but part of that problem, again, is people work to make money. They start businesses to make money. If they're not making, you know, a reasonable profit is expected, 7, 8, 9, even 10%. But, you know, nobody should be making over that on a killing, on a windfall. But if you're not making that profit, there's no incentive to be there. And the other thing is, 80% of our nation is small business.
Right.
You know, and those people work on margins that are just 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7% maximum. So there's not a lot of play there. And when their costs go up, they have two choices, either to absorb it, or three choices, or cut back on labor where they can, or just pass the price on, which is going to affect their customers coming in. So they don't have a lot of playroom.
I'm not concerned so much about that. I'm concerned about like the big numbers, right? Because little mom and pop shops, again, they're eking out what they can, but companies that like the oil companies that are showing record high profits over the, you know, highest ever in 70 years, 50 to 70, depending on which report you read, that could be loosened a little bit, that, you know, a $10 million a year bonus on a $1 million a year salary could probably take a $1 million hit to sort of help offset the damage that it's doing to the regular, the little people. Another one that really kills me is, like, right now there's still paid parking in some of these spots where little businesses that, you know, are mom and pop shops on Carolina Beach are losing business because people just don't want to pay to go park down there. And then you're crushing the people that work there because they have to pay for parking just to work. And some of these parking rates are nearly a third of what they make on an hourly basis. And none of this is working out in their favor. It's not helping.
No, it doesn't help the consumer. It doesn't help the businessman. It doesn't help the workers either. The only people it helps is those people in seats of power that have to find another reason to spend more money needlessly.
And that's sort of where I start, like, diverging from a lot of the political structure, because, again, you know, I'm sort of naive, I guess, that I desire a utopian sharing type of environment when, you know, if you can burn $44 billion to tank Twitter, you know, I'm thinking there was one, you know, you could have made one other decision, Mr. Musk, that not necessarily begging you to be the philanthropic, you know, king of the world, but at least something. I don't know. It just, there's a lot more problems in the world than Twitter that could have been fixed.
You know, but they say something, you know, and I don't know how current these numbers are. They're a couple of years old, so they may not be exactly accurate. But if they confiscated all the wealth of everybody over $10 million in this nation, and I'm not a fan of that, but if they did, it would run our government for less than 10 days.
And I'm not a fan of saying, you know, you can't have profit. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is there's a point where grotesque becomes offensive.
Well, you know, part of the problem is, you know, capitalism has its great points because it allows people to, with an idea, to move out of a class and move up and, you know, do something with it. Crony capitalism is another issue. And, you know, and that's something that cannot be supported. That means if you're taken care of because you're a friend of government, there's a problem. I'll give you an example. Right now, the biggest crony capitalists going on right now are the big pharma.
Exactly, right.
They're making obscene profits off of all these meds that are out, that are being sold for COVID. And two things have happened. The government has eliminated a lot of the taxes they're going to pay for. And secondly, they've limited the fact if they make a bad product that we can't even go after them to recover legitimate losses or deaths in family, you know, some sort of punitive action for what they've done. So that's crony capitalism, and that's got to stop.
And that's across more than one industry, but that and the healthcare cartel are just two examples of using our health as a weapon against us.
I agree. Unfortunately, government is weaponizing a great number of institutions we have, from big pharma. You go literally, FBI's become a weaponized event. Years ago, they weaponized the IRS, and it's still an issue with them. And they're there to serve you, not to cook you.
Yeah, that's a good theme to have this year.
Yeah, let's be served rather than be served. So
right.
it's an interesting issue with all that. You know, but you know what people don't also realize, and I will not mention a friend of mine who you might know, who's been in business and struggled through COVID, and managed to keep his business open, and it's a fitness center, and unfortunately this past week he's announced that he's closing his doors by the end of the year, because with the inflation issue, people are making a decision: do they feed or they go pay to work out at a gym? And you know, and that's a bummer. It is a bummer. And I think you know who I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah. And it took the creativity to make it through COVID.
Yes, it did. And he struggled. I was with him during most of those times. I was a member of his club, and I watched what they had to do to survive. They shut their gym in half, literally, and got rid of excess space so they could make it workable. And unfortunately, his membership is vastly shrinking again, because people have to make a decision: can they afford to pay for a gym, or are they putting gas in the car, or are they, you know, feeding the family, or are they paying for the heat to take care of their home this winter? And it's got him to the point now where he hasn't got any choice, and that's sad. That's very sad.
Yep. And when you're not given, when your options are being eliminated in real time, that's not a good sign.
No, it's not. And you know, I feel for that person a great deal, because he is a friend, he's a mutual friend. And
he's smart. He knows his stuff. It's not like it's a lunk.
No, he's been doing this for 20, 30 years, but out of state and in state. And, you know, he's going to try and survive by moving it strictly to an online business where you can zoom in on him at a cheaper rate and work out at home using your TV, using your computer. You know, and I hope for him that it works, because he's able to lower the price a great deal to see if people will come. I would tell you, you know, and again, not to be negative for him, but I think we have proved with the school issue that remote learning is not exactly the most ideal situation for anybody. And
because it's got to be hard to, like, in his case, to correct for, because the biggest, I remember his conversation is that bad form is, you know, the bad form is what will do the most damage. And if he can't be there to actually help you protect your form so that you don't get hurt working out, that's going to be, you know, problematic for a number of people that aren't going to have that guidance they need. So
yeah, if you put your, you know, my, on my computers now, you're looking at me. If I'm standing behind me exercising, or I have to drop to the floor to do an exercise, you have no idea what I'm doing.
Right.
You know, you have no idea once my hands go above you, am I doing anything right up here? I mean, it's, he'll do his best he can. I wish him all the luck in the world, and I hope he survives this, and I hope he can come back somewhere down the road. But, you know, it's just sad to see him and many other businesses going, you know, hands up, feet up, to just, it's because of inflation and because there's no solution in the near future.
Man, that's... Well, that's not making my my holiday cheer any greater than it was.
No, I understand that. It's just it's a matter that we need to consider. Every action that we take has a reaction, and you have to care. And if you're an elitist, and I hate to use that term now, but that's what you are. If you're sitting there with $1 million or $10 million or $1 billion. Yeah, my prices went up by 30, 40, 50%. Yeah, so that means I will buy one year less of champagne, or I'll buy a little cheaper version of champagne. But my life goes on. But too many people's lives go on hold and actually go into the reverse mode in a car. So that's something we need to be looking at. And we need to elect people who are going to address those issues and going to address what's right for the country and not what's right for them, either for power purposes or whatever reasons.
Man, amen. And it's a hard line to kind of follow, because again, as you mentioned, being the small business country that we are, we want to encourage small business to be successful. But on the other end of the spectrum, when it becomes so successful, for example, like the Amazon situation, where there's just so much insane money that's going to stupid stuff as opposed to some sort of philanthropic or community-based, you know, solutions to help offset some of this. But, you know, again, that's violating where you can have a profit and how much profit you can have. That would be very much not supported in any sort of political arena.
Well, no, and I understand that part, but we need to be thinking of these individuals. We really need to be realizing that every decision that government makes affects a great number of people, and mostly negative. You know, food banks, you know, again, my wife was talking to a friend of hers from New York, and their church runs a food bank for 2 hours once a month, and people stop by. And normally, and it was just run this past Sunday, and normally they have, you know, they do 2 hours and they get X number of people that come through there and they're gone. Well, they ended up opening for 5 hours because the lines were so long. And they ran, you know,
man.
You know, and that's just indicative. And then she was also personally upset because probably she's met like 300 people in that time frame that they took care of. And only about 10 or 20% of them actually said thank you.
Wow.
And that's another issue. I mean, if people are going out of their way to work for you, at least we can be polite and say thank you. You know, and that's a two-sided street.
I've seen that. The Wilmington Residential Adolescent Achievement Program every year has a massive, I mean, it's so massive, they use Army guys to unload all the food from the trucks to distribute to the community here in Wilmington. And a lot of these people, they're just stepping over each other to grab a box and run off like, you know, little scamps. And very few of them, you know, I see a lot more of the parents that are grateful. Thank you for, you know, this meal for my family. But there are a lot of individuals, mostly men, that are just like, yo, where's my, which one's mine? I'll take it home. There wasn't a lot of interaction or, you know, there's empathy on the side of the Wilmington Residential Adolescent Achievement Program, the RAP program, to provide for that community, because they're trying to help the children and the families of those children so that they can be raised a little bit better than they would have been.
You know, when you start talking about that, you're absolutely right. You know, I take you into Brunswick. There's a group called Matthews Ministry that works mid-county. And this is run by Superior Judge Jason Desbro's wife. And Matthews Ministry provides backpacks to kids over the weekend so they have food to eat when they go home. And, you know, you think about a county as big and as boisterous and as growing as Brunswick, and you don't think about hunger. You don't think about hunger. You don't think about a lot of those things. But literally, if my numbers are correct, I believe they gave out something in the neighborhood of 500 backpacks a weekend.
Damn.
You know, and that's just kids in various schools.
And that's every weekend.
That's every weekend. They got to bring them back on Monday so they can get refilled to pick up for next weekend. And, you know, it's all the volunteer work. It's all volunteers donating things. Businesses that are donating excess food or something, whatever else that's place. It's called Matthew's Ministry. And they strictly deal with sending kids home on weekends with a backpack full of food so they can have enough food to get through the Monday. And it has nothing to do with the food program the government runs. This is all privately run and worked.
Man, not giving me the warm fuzzies that I was hoping for a Thanksgiving show, Thanksgiving week show.
You know, again, but it's then we have to realize how fortunate we are and still being, you know, an adult, a Christian, someone that cares, we need to reach out and help people. You know, there's a line out there that says, you know, the government provides everything for everybody. You don't need to give anything else. Well, there's a couple of problems with that. First of all, the government shouldn't be doing it. And secondly, we should be taking care of our neighbors. I mean, that's been the tradition and forever. Go back historically, civilization, you know, there's an old line from an African community. It takes a village to raise a child.
Yep.
Well, we have to take care of each other. We have to stop the let someone else worry about it or they're getting it all for nothing from somebody else. Because, yeah, I'm sure there are some people out there scamming the system. There's not a system in the world that's perfect. However, the reality is there's a whole lot of people out there that need help. And that list is growing instead of shrinking based on what's going on in our government now with inflation, with the refusal to use our own natural resources to cut the gas price back. And believe me, gas is a major cause or reason for the inflation that we're running. You know, whether you like Trump or you don't like Trump, or you don't like what he said, you don't like his talks, but his policies, when he left office, we were energy exporter to other countries. And our gas was $1.87 a gallon, $2 a gallon. You know, look at where we are now, and we now import gas from around the world. And one of the other advantages we had when we exported, Europe was not so dependent on Russia because of what we were exporting to them. But all those are factors that politically were made to, quote, you know, save the environment with the green energy and whatever else. Look, safe fuels. You know, we're shutting down coal plants. China's opening up coal plants. Germany's opening up a coal plant now because they realize that their programs are not working with green energy, and they've got to provide it, and they don't have to worry about Russia providing them what they need with their pipelines. It's fascinating that our government can support a pipeline in Europe but shut down a pipe down in our own country that would allow fuel to come in, gasoline to come in, oil to come in, to be processed and either shipped out and or used in our country to keep the prices low. You know, and again, if you know, I'm a student of history. You go back and look at wars, they're all fought over natural resources at some level, people being a natural resources, and the natural resources, including, you know, location, natural resources like silver, gold.
Fertile land.
For growing whatever you need. Wars were fought over that. Think of it this way.
Isn't that still happening in Ukraine? Because Ukraine is the breadbasket of Europe.
And they absolutely are. And, you know, that's why they've been making arrangements, even though there's a war. The Russians have agreed not to interfere with the grain shipments because they realize how important that is. And I think from their own viewpoint, they realize if they do, there can be more people they have to deal with. But we need to be looking natural resources. And what happens to the world when they run out of all their stuff and we're sitting here on a plethora of natural gas, a plethora of oil? Don't you think they're going to come knocking? I mean, it's just logic. And I'm all for green energy if it works, when it works. You know, I'll give you an example of something that came out this weekend. Scotland is moving to windmills Which, if they want to do that, that's their right. And if they think it works, that's their right.
Don Quixote all over.
Yeah. However, 15 million trees were cut down to do the windmills.
Well, we do that to put up car washes in Wilmington, so that's not a fair that's not a fair argument.
A country of the size of probably maybe North Carolina, slip a little bit either way. 15 million trees is a lot of trees.
Oh yeah.
And if you start talking about trees and oxygen, remember trees put that, take the carbon monoxide and turn it into oxygen, which keeps the balance running for us to breathe. That's why, all things being equal, trees are renewable energy. You can plant more and grow them, and that works. However, when you start doing what they're doing in Brazil and taking down that rainforest, that's a major hunk of where we're getting our oxygen for the world. So that concerns me too.
But yeah, green, but the tree is more valuable as lumber and timber than oxygen will be right now. So yeah, why not today, profit on what will kill us tomorrow?
Today it's more valuable.
Are these not elements of a dystopian slide? Wonder why I read so much sci-fi from the 50s, 40s, and 50s, and the dystopian overtones are not inaccurate.
I sometimes science fiction is actually just a prediction of what we're going to be in.
And a reflection of where we came from, because a lot of this happened, in 39 through 45.
That's true. But we do need to work on natural resources. We need to work on alternative energies, because it's true, in a couple of hundred years, there's going to be no fuel left. And that may change because as our population grows. I believe we just hit 8 billion people in the last year, the last couple of weeks, because there was an article about the 8 billionth child being born. So we have 8 billion people in the world.
How exciting.
Keep in mind that the UN says that 80% of them live at some level of extreme poverty.
And we don't know to stop procreating.
Well,
but that's me. That's one of the arguments where if we had an awareness of ourselves that a lot of the lower incomes environment, people in the lower income environment across the world, the only free enjoyment they have is sex.
Well, that's true. But beyond that, you also get into the fact that you're living in places where, even historically, we have a lot of children because a good slice of them are not going to make it to adulthood.
Yep. And that's one of the side stories in, I think it's Heinlein, Stranger in a Strange Land, where on Mars, in that particular book, the offspring, the newts, they call them, or nymphs rather, are unsupervised, and they create billions of them during each breeding cycle, and 90% of them are going to die from being stupid, and they actually are okay with it, because the ones that survive are going to be the ones that are going to be effective in the next generation.
Mm-hmm.
Did that make sense? So there's a whole different approach to raising children in their environment that they're completely hands off. If they fall out of a tree, fall off a cliff, get eaten by a bear, whatever, that's nature. The ones that survive are the ones that are going to be useful.
Going back to survival of the fittest, that's a basic premise that we run most of our world in, because they live in environments that's very, very dangerous and not conducive either with animals or with diseases that will just wipe out parts of families.
Yep. Yep. And it doesn't even require a bullet or a war or anything like that. It just,
Let me throw that in and just think what we can do to mess people up. I think the saddest part is the maiming that's going on in Africa. And that's just absolutely ludicrous. And no one's doing, I don't know what they can do about it, to be honest. But
that's the other thing. When a problem gets so big, all of the ideas that we have to solve it just pale.
Yeah.
It's like holding a candle to the sun. There's just no way to compete with that, how it got to that level.
For those of you who are not sure what I'm talking about with the maiming, there are several tribes or leadership groups in these African countries that they're opposing people. They will cut off their arm or their leg and maim them so they cannot be a danger to them down the road. And yep. You have numbers of men and even women walking around with an arm missing or walking on stilts where they've lost a leg that were purposely cut off for no other reason that you were the opposing tribe, and I'm worried about you coming back to get even with me. So.
And at that point, it's just so nutty.
Yep. And I came on the show, although thinking that I was going to do a Thanksgiving talk and it was all going to be nice and sweet and cool. And I'm not painting a real good picture for Thanksgiving, but it is a reality that we need to face as a country.
We can't hide from this.
No, we as a world, we need to face that, you know. The one good thing about America is America's exceptionalism has just been reigned for 200 years. We've gone out there and we've done things that nobody thought we could do. And we have raised our standard of living. I remember in the 60s or 70s when Prime Minister Gandhi, Indira, the daughter of Mr. Gandhi, came over here and she was touring around and looking at our country. And somebody asked her, what would you take back from this country to your country? And her answer was absolutely very thought-provoking. I would like to take back the fact, I'd like to make all my poor the poor at your level. I would make them the poor at your level. Well, because if you start looking at, we think what's poor here, and then you compare what's poor outside of this nation, undeveloped countries, even, there's no comparison.
Like some of the countries, and this is what was hard, I can't remember the series, but they were doing, this is, I don't know, 10, 15 years old now, but the relationship made sense that they were showing, by comparing whatever their monetary unit is to our own, right? So they equated everything to a dollar so us white people could understand it. And then they're like, some of the poor people in America have $30 a week to live on, right? So they're living under a bridge and they're having their, ramen noodles and doing what they can with the 30 bucks or so that they have. Whereas in another country, the same family, the same group of four people has a dollar for the entire month with the same relative cost of, rice and noodles and whatever else, that trying to survive at our poverty level in another country would be living like kings.
Yes.
If you have $30.
If she could take back our poverty level and put it through India, she said everything would be great over there. And she, and we tend to forget that. I say this and I don't mean it negatively because I fight weight on a regular basis. But when you look at the poor in other countries and the poor in our country, there's not a real weight issue outside this nation.
A weight issue?
As far as the size of the poor, as far as
numbers.
No, I'm not doing all numbers. I'm doing size, literally.
Like each person's size.
Yes. I mean, there are a lot of people that are considered poor in our country that are also considered grossly overweight. Whereas you go to other countries around the world, that doesn't exist. They're probably skin and bone.
Yeah, they just wrap themselves in a hand towel.
Yep.
Because that's all they need.
So, we have certain advantages in this country that we need to be thankful for. And Thanksgiving is one of those times we need to be thankful for what this country has, what this country's produced, and the potential that we have around. But at the same token, while we're being thankful, we need to remember that there are a whole lot of people not as fortunate as we are. And I say that at whatever level you are, there's always somebody worse than you. There's always somebody better than you. So you need to be thankful for where you are. And
to use that as an incentive, use that as your inspiration.
Yeah, that works.
Like kicking in a little bit of extra hustle. I know some people, and so do you, that have all the hustle of a trust fund baby, that they could be doing so much more for so many more people if they were to, actually concern themselves with that environment, with that entrepreneurial process or whatever it is they're into. They can certainly hustle a little bit more to make it worth the while for everybody in it, if that makes sense. So if you're working at a restaurant, like a fast food joint, making $11 an hour and you're hustling and they see that, you now make 12 or 13 an hour because they see your value. But if you're literally showing up and just punching a ticket and trying to, sneak off into the back room and, leave the work to everybody else, they notice that. And I think really having hustle is one of the saving graces we have in America.
And I agree. And I think that that hustle makes the difference for us compared to around the world. But again, you know, if you go back, again, let's go back to communism when it was first set up in Russia, and they put the communes in. And the communes were all there, and the people had to go out. They worked on common land, and they got the harvest, and they all shared in the harvest, and they got whatever they paid. It really wasn't. Russia had these 5-year plans for growth and for economic growth, and none of them were working. And what made the difference was they decided to take a little bit of that commune property and give each worker there a little piece of land that was theirs. And whatever they grew on it was theirs to use, eat, sell, whatever they wanted. And all of a sudden, production went up greatly.
Because ownership.
Yeah, there you go. That's the word.
And, that's sort of the thing. When you own your own skill or your own, you know, because being, you know, tilling the land is as much of a skill as designing a computer.
Yes, it is.
And to capitalize on that, to be something that you own can make a big difference in how you approach it for others, that it becomes more of a community environment, right? Where people are supporting what you do because you're supporting that environment, that community.
You know, and people don't realize, again, let's go back to the mom and pop stores that are 80% of the country. How many of them, on that small bit of profit, they try to hire locals to work part-time for them, but at $15 an hour, they can't.
Nope.
And beyond that, as they go down the tubes, they're the ones that support the little leagues, that support the food banks, that support, you know,
dance, these, after school dance and after school sports and whatever. Music,
you know,
camp.
They'll find a PTA's activity. They'll give you something to raffle off to help make money for some sort of activity.
And you can't even do a bake sale if you can't afford the crap to make the stuff to make the bake sale with, to raise money with.
That's true.
I mean, that's, you know, that was the way of making money when we were kids, right? You had a little bake sale on Saturday or Friday after school or whatever.
Yeah, or individually we sold Kool-Aid in the soda. We went around and we found bottles that we took back and cashed in for whatever we needed to do, even was buy a ball so we could play sports.
Because, yeah, that's it. Man. So, yeah, happy Thanksgiving, I guess, is sort of the theme of this show. Holy cow, get plucked and shaved like a bird.
Well, the theme of the show is, as far as I'm concerned, is we all need to be thankful for where we are and what we have for this Thanksgiving, but we need to remember to help others because there are people a lot worse off than any one of us. And I don't think we should be as jealous of the people above us. If they've earned that right to be there, then you can try to make it yourself. But be happy we are and help those that need their help. And I think that's the theme of Thanksgiving. You know, and thank God for where you are.
Yeah, man. Well, I look forward to seeing you guys tomorrow evening as a group. I believe I'll have you and Mary and Greta.
Yeah, Dan is going to take a day off. Or he's got some things to do.
Yeah, he's got to cover this. But now what's going to be interesting is you are now going to be estrogen overload, 2-1. So the rose between two thorns.
Exactly. No, I will be the thorn between two roses.
Oh, there you go. That's more accurate. You're right. That is far more accurate.
We do have the mayor of Boiling Springs Lakes coming on with us tonight, and he's going to be discussing, you know, there was a bond issue to help rebuild the lakes in destroyed by the hurricanes in Boiling Springs Lakes area. And there's some controversy because, and I'm going to use round numbers, $20 million is what this is going to cost. Some money was brought in from the state level and some federal level, thanks to our local representatives and Charlie Miller in particular in this one. So they don't need as much money. So the bond, unfortunately, was written to go on the ballot before the money came in. So they asked for the whole $20 million. They may only need $7 or $8 million now. And there are people out there dancing, well, yes, what are you going to do with that extra $12 million? Well, we're going to find out tonight.
We're going to buy Tesla. No, we should buy. What we should do is buy Twitter. And from all the profit of Twitter, you could, you know, feed all of Brunswick County.
Forever. I will leave you with a thought. Sir Donald's back on Twitter.
I saw that. And that's one of the reasons why I will never have Twitter. I like talking with adults. Oh, well, there you go. I'm sorry. That's, you know, well, that's why I have you and Dan and other cats on the show, because you are individual adults that actually have to wear a pair of shoes and actually drive yourself somewhere. Right. These are, he's one of these people that's so disconnected from any sense of reality. He has never bought food in his life. He has never been grocery shopping like you and me, comparing the cost of one brand of, you know, the generic brand of beans versus the Del Monte.
Yep. That's right? A reality. My wife will say many a year she went through those lines and was buying the store brand rather than the name brand, because it was. That's what our budget would allow.
Exactly. So until somebody knows my pain, I don't want to listen to them, because what you're saying is a load of crap, because you don't know what life is like. You're in a gilded golden toilet world. I don't want to hear from you. I want to hear from the people that have gone from, I was making $30 a month to support my four member family, to being self-sufficient without being a criminal.
Okay, well, we're not going to get into that, because I will talk to you. I'll talk to you tomorrow night, my friend.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for joining. And for the rest of you folks, we are about to take a bit of a news break, news, weather, and other stuff. All I got to do is call up some music here. Let's see if I can do that. Oh, that's pretty tasty. I like that. I like that. You like that? I hope you like that, because that's what we're getting. And if you don't mind, see, I'm going to do a little clicky-clicky here. See if I can't get some of this stuff straightened out. Get us ready for the next one. And with that in mind, oh, look at that. Man, this is actually, I hate it when things go too well, because then I know something's going to go really wrong later. So with that in mind, ladies and gentlemen, we will be right back after these messages right here on The Asylum, your refuge in a world gone mad. Yeah, don't go nowhere, so we'll be right back.
Hello, I'm Matt Bennett with WWAY News. Today is Veterans Day, and here are some of the events happening in our area. UNCW's Office of Military Affairs will be hosting its Veterans Day ceremony this morning. The annual event celebrates veterans and military-affiliated students and families. It will be in the lobby of Veterans Hall at 10:45. All students, staff, and faculty are invited. Cape Fear Community College's Division of Veterans Services will also hold a ceremony to honor military veterans today. That's happening at 11 a.m. behind the L and G buildings. In the event of inclement weather, organizers say the ceremony will take place in Union Station, Room 170. Due to anticipated rainy weather, the Veterans Day event in Southport has been moved to the Fire Department headquarters. That event is happening at 2 o'clock this afternoon. Boy Scout Troop 296 will hold a Veterans Day flag retirement ceremony at 11 a.m. That is happening behind the Family Life Center of Northside Church, 2501 North College Road in Wilmington. Everyone is invited. The New Hanover County District Attorney's Office has a new prosecutor position that will focus on gang violence cases. The new role comes after commissioners approved a grant for the DA's office to add that position. Assistant District Attorney Brad Matthews will be stepping into the new role. Currently, he is on the drug team in the DA's office, but in his new position, he will work specifically on cases that involve active gang members and work closely with task forces, the U.S. Attorney's Office, and several law enforcement agencies. District Attorney Ben David believes the new position will help address people's fear of retaliation when reporting gang-related crimes. He also hopes it will deter gang members from committing crimes in the first place. For more on any of these stories, including additional Veterans Day events and cancellations or postponements, you can head over to our website at WWAYTV3.com. I'm Matt Bennett. Have a great day.
Happy Monday, everybody. I'm WWAY meteorologist Romel Carpenter with the Storm Track 3 forecast. Another chilly one here in the Cape Fear, but a bit warmer compared to our Sunday. I'm expecting a bit more sunshine in the Cape Fear as well, allowing our temperatures to warm up into the upper 50s and the lower 60s for coastal and inland communities. So our temperatures still running about 6 or 7 degrees below the average. But as we head towards the overnight hours tonight, temperatures fall down into the low to middle 40s away from the coast, middle and upper 40s along the immediate coastline. Get your full forecast on WWAY and WWAYTV3.com.
This news and weather is brought to you by Two Men and a Truck. For your free quote, go to twomenandatruck.com. Twomenandatruck.com.
Folks, the sad truth of it is most of what we're seeing in the news cycle is just noise, and it's recycled noise at that. Nothing informative, nothing that actually helps us discern the times that we live in. That's why we started doing Herd Tell. Every morning right here on Big Talker Network, 7 a.m. with a replay at 3 p.m., we talk and discuss the issues of the day, culture and politics, with knowledgeable guests, no yelling, no caterwauling, just grown folk talk about the issues that matter. Join me, Andrew Donaldson, every weekday morning for Herd Tell.
Hope Abounds, North Carolina's premier cancer support network, invites you to attend our Gift of Hope by Giving to Others event on Saturday, November 12th at 6 p.m. at the Wrightsville Beach Holiday and Resort, with music provided by Ray Kennedy and the Opera House Theater Company. So join us for an evening of food, music, hope, information, a live auction, and more, while supporting the hard work of the Hope Abounds Cancer Network. For more information, please call us at 910-799-7178 or visit us online at hopeabounds.org.
It seems like every other store is now selling CBD in some form or another. But did you know that Wilmington has just one local CBD company? I'm talking about Carolina Pure. Family owned and operated, they are Wilmington's first and only CBD company that makes quality hemp products right here in town, including tinctures, topicals, and pet products. Their hemp is sourced from local farmers, and they support area musicians and nonprofits. Check us out at CarolinaPureShop.com.
Quand il me prend dans ses bras, il me parle tout bas, je vois la vie en rose.
MusicRewind.com is serving Cafe Culture 100 songs to enjoy with your coffee. A perfect blend of music from across the globe.
Just stop and take a little time out with me.
Get Cafe Just Culture today at MusicRewind.com or call 855-798-5556 and pay only $21.98 for this 4-CD World Music Collection. Use promo code CAFE55 to save on shipping. Take the journey with MusicRewind.com or call 855-798-5556. Remember promo code CAFE55 for reduced shipping.
This offer is available for a limited time to U.S. residents only and cannot be combined with any other offer.
Hey, welcome back to the Asylum, your refuge in a world gone mad. Not a whole lot of options left open to us this holiday season. Doing what we can with what we got, with what's left. Rebuilding the stuff as best we can with what we got. So, you know, all of us, all of you, working together through this cold weather, which, you know, here's another point I would like to make. The 23 degree tilt of the Earth's rotational axis to the orbital plane is why we have seasons. And as human beings, we discovered long, long ago that if we plant our food in the spring, we can harvest in the fall so we have food over the winter. That was the first significant step in overcoming our environment, allowing us to live longer and presumably more productive lives. So when I hear idiots moaning and being cutesy on air or on their little Facebook crap trying to say, hey, you know, well, who turned off the heat and whatever else, and man, quit being stupid. It's not cute. It makes you look like an ignorant ass. Except if you really understood how the hell this worked, you would just go collect your food in the fall, squirrel away your nuts, as it were, so that you would have stuff to eat over the winter. You know, wear an extra pair of socks, put on a jacket, whatever. But winter has been with us millennia. Since the first monkeys fell out of the tree and started tilling the land, I think we can do better than the type of complaining crap that we see left and right. Yeah, it's cold outside. Baby, it's cold outside. Yeah, surprise. I mean, we all have a weather app on our smartphone that will tell you, hey, tomorrow's going to be damned cold. Put on some socks. I mean, what? How collectively stupid have we become that we can't handle? Ah, jeez. I'm sorry, I'm probably gonna get fired for that. Because it's just aggravating as hell. Let's see, Oh, this sounds like too much fun. All right. New York Post, I love these guys. Stop it, get off of me. I'm not playing. All right, hard partying baboons crash woman's birthday getaway in a viral video. She says, I'm traumatized. Written by Asia Grace for the New York Post. Let's see. These uninvited house guests were real party animals, helping themselves to shots of hard liquor, a freshly cooked brunch spread, and several bags of chips. A pair of bold baboons broke into a woman's rental home in, I'm not going to pronounce it, Knysna, South Africa, and nearly destroyed her birthday breakfast celebration. I'm going to quote Esetu Zoe Williams. Esetu. Baboons just came inside our house, ate our avocados we were making for breakfast, and drank our Hennessy. She exclaimed in a now viral tweet on Saturday. She then shared footage of the hairy intruders monkeying around in her Airbnb's kitchen. I'm traumatized, Williams confessed in a subsequent tweet, which carried up more than 84,000 likes. The post featured a video of a primate hopping from counter to counter, popping open bags of chips while she and her screaming friends cowered in fear. In a separate clip with over 291,000 views, one of the badass baboons is seen guzzling glasses of brandy that were left outside on the patio of the property as Williams and her pals watched from a window. It finished an entire glass and almost left with the empty glass. Well, I know many bar patrons who've done that, usually because they're trying to be trickery and they want matching glasses at home, so they just steal it from the bar. And Williams, with more than 4,000 Twitter followers, most of whom were sympathetic, found great humor in her monkey house of horrors. Life is hard everywhere. They needed that alcohol break, commented one user amused by the baboon's unabashed swig of Hennessy. Another quote, someone said these things are human beings but pretend as if they can't speak just to avoid paying taxes. Drinking Hennessy, joked another, adding a series of laughing emoji for emphasis. Others shared their own unexpected encounters with apes while on vacation. A monkey came to our table on the patio and took our Chateau Gâteau cake in Zambali. I haven't healed, one commenter revealed. In a statement to Storyful, Williams revealed that the jungle-dwelling trespasser strolled into her rented abode after she and her friends forgot to close the door behind them because they were raised in a damn barn. We had mistakenly left the door open while making breakfast when two baboons entered. They ate eggs, avocado, and bread before proceeding to pop the snacks. Well, good job. Luckily, she and her party managed to give the baboons the boot and resume their birthday brunch festivities. We eventually got them out by screaming and charging towards them. When they were outside, they drank the liquor that had been left there from the previous day. See, slobs. And once the monkeys fled, she and her friends enjoyed a scenic meal outdoors. Restored, she captioned a video showcasing their seaside monkey-free breakfast. Yeah, well, a lot of that is an error on your own part, leaving booze around. Because you're just slobs. You're entitled little slobs that just thought, hey, I'm going to be cool and leave all my... Yeah, you idiot. In a way, I would say you deserved every last bit of that. Here's another stupid human trick. This one just keeps going. Oh, there's no commentary on it. Oh, man, so that doesn't help. Man dies falling 40 feet while attempting a cliffside selfie. Dumbass. Man dies after falling 40 feet while attempting a cliffside selfie. That's all the text I get on it. I'm not going to show you the video. It's just stupid human trips. Oh, well then. This is interesting. This is sort of an insight to ourselves coming from USA Today, Orlando Mallorcan. I think I got that right. Researchers played Lady Gaga for rats, and they bopped their heads like humans. No way. All right, blasting Lady Gaga in your house, there's a chance a nearby rat might be bopping along with you, a new study suggests. Yes, rats can recognize and move to the rhythm of a beat, according to a University of Tokyo study published in the peer-reviewed journal Science Advances. Only humans have had been... Oh, wait, take two. Only humans had been thought to innately possess the ability, according to university's news release. Researchers played Mozart, Lady Gaga's Born This Way, Michael Jackson's Beat It, Queen's Another One Bites the Dust, and Sugar by Maroon 5 for rats, and measured their head movements before comparing their results to humans who participated in the study. They played the music at four different tempos and found rats best synchronized their head bops to music in the 120 to 140 beats per minute range, much like humans, according to the study. Yeah, because other tempos don't really have a groove. And it really, that comes down to the bass player. If you have a good bass line executed well by a good bass player, you can't help but bop, man. You know what I'm saying? But if it's some crazy, stupid, like, Daft Punk crap, it's really hard to get into because it's all just... Animals can be trained to move to a beat, but the rats in this study demonstrated an innate ability to groove, according to the news release. Animals are known to respond to music in reactive fashion, but that is not the same as recognizing a beat, responding to it, or predicting it, the university said in its statement. Researchers call the ability to naturally recognize a beat in a song beat synchronicity. Ooh, there sounds like a song being made. The rats in the study did bop their heads in a more reactive manner than their human counterparts, but their movements also showed signs of being predictive at some points. Researchers ultimately concluded that the rat's beat synchronization could neither be characterized as being purely reactive nor be explained only by startles. The most outrageous MTV... To the best of our knowledge, this is the first report on innate beat synchronization in animals that was not achieved through training or musical exposure, Takahashi said in a news release. Takahashi also told USA Today that the study was also the first to use the, quote, precise measurement of accelerometers. Past studies investigated only visually and therefore might overlook the synchronization, Takahashi said. And that's it for that one. Okay, well, that was pretty quick. I guess you can do what you want with that, but yeah, bebop along with your favorite rat. But, you know, the beat goes on. Uh-oh. United Kingdom got one up on us. Oh, man. This one's pretty... Woo! All right. So, this man can't figure out how to save the world. Nobody will. Boy, 11 years old, hits highest possible Mensa IQ score, beating Einstein and Hawking. 11-year-old Yusuf Shah scored 162 on the IQ test, the maximum for under 18, and in the top 1% of all people. I think I scored like a 12. An 11-year boy scored the highest point on beating out geniuses. I mean, I usually have 11 registered ones. Okay. They just typed that twice or copy-paste. Yusuf outstripped Mr. Hawking's reported 160. And while Einstein never took the Mensa exam, he is believed to have scored the same. The 11-year-old celebrated his amazing achievement with a meal at Nando's with his parents and brothers, according to a remarkable... Adding to the remarkable score, Yusuf sat the exam... Wow, this is... English is hard. Yusuf sat the exam in a room full of adults and scored in the top 1% of all people. Yusuf sat the exam. Yusuf... Took the exam in a room full of adults? That would make more sense. So that'll be the verb I go with. Yusuf took the exam in a room full of adults and scored in the top 1% of all people. That makes more sense. Only in year 6, Yusuf hopes to study mathematics at Cambridge or Oxford. He said, "Everyone at school thinks I am very smart, and I have always wanted to know if I was in the top 2% of the world who take the test. It feels very special. It feels special to have a certificate for me and about me." Yusuf also likes solving Sudoku puzzles and Rubik's Cubes, picking up the block puzzles in January. After seeing one at a friend's house at the start of the year, he was able to solve any difficulty of cube within a month. That's not a very fair... Anyway, Sana, Yusuf's proud mum, said, I was so proud. He is the first person to take the Mensa test in the family. I was actually a little concerned, too. He has always gone into a hall full of kids to take the test, so we thought it might be intimidated. We thought he might be intimidated by the adults at the center, but he did brilliantly. I still tell him that. Your dad is still smarter than you. We take it all lightheartedly. Even if you are talented, you still have... Even if you are talented, you have to be the hardest worker. Yusuf's father, Irfan, also praised his son, saying, it is a difficult test to prepare for. We just did what we were already doing, nothing specific for the IQ test. Meanwhile, Yusuf's brother, Khalid, aged 8, is also hoping to take the Mensa test when he's older. Yeah, no competition there. That's gonna tear a family apart. Well, at least it would in America, right? White people don't handle competition well. Let's see. Oh. Are you kidding me? Another monkey story. Oh, okay. So we'll do that one in a moment. Provided I don't get a phone call here shortly. Oh, come on, you Substack. News.com.au staff writer, so they're not going to take credit for this silliness, for this monkey shine. The headline is Hansi Monkey Goes Wild on Former Miss Peru in Bali. Footage of a naughty monkey trying to pull down the top of an international model before lashing out has recently gone viral. Yeah, video and it didn't happen. It's not really a trip to Bali without a run-in with a monkey. But an incident with a Peruvian model proves how cheeky the local primates can be. Footage of a monkey trying to pull down the strapless top of 28-year-old former Miss Peru, Paula Manzanal, has recently gone viral while posing with a monkey in the Indonesian island's Ubud Monkey Forest. A cheeky long-tailed macaque is filmed trying to yank down Manzanal's top. Man, the thing's hungry. As his attempt to expose the model's breast fails, the monkey then resorts to violence, hissing and slapping Manzala in the face before the video cuts out. I just didn't want it to touch me, she captioned the social video on social media translated from Spanish. I just didn't want it to touch me. I bet she says that to most people. Manzanal's 2.1 million TikTok followers shared concern for the model. Be thankful it didn't bite you, one follower exclaimed. It could hurt your eye. Be very careful with the little animals. They get scared and react like that. I hope you are fine. Get off of me. I think his little fingernail got caught and he must have thought that they wanted to tie him up and he got scared. Plenty of others saw the funny side of the interspecies dispute. I didn't want to laugh, but it did make me laugh. The good thing is that it didn't bite you. He definitely knew what he was doing, another wrote. Thank you, little monkey, on behalf of all followers, wrote another audacious follower. Ubud Monkey Forest, also known as the Sacred Monkey Forest of Padangtigal, I guess, is home to over 700 gray long-tailed macaques. The park monkeys are generally considered friendly, but are well known to bite or scratch if provoked or allured by food, especially mother monkeys with babies. And also, don't leave your booze outside for the monkeys. They don't take that stuff well. Here's a couple of just completely out of control stories that are probably going to be like gross. Matthew Sadacha, I don't know how to pronounce it. I lived with my dead neighbor's blood dripping into my apartment for 2 weeks. That's the headline. Oy. His apartment was a bloody mess. Oh, that's bad. A central Harlem woman's living situation turned into a scene out of The Shining, with blood running down her walls and from her ceiling after her upstairs neighbor died and was left to rot for at least 3 days. Good Lord. I was lost for words, said disgusted resident Elizabeth Parker. This is like a real horror movie. The nightmare on West 116th Street began 5 days before Halloween. Oy. Hey, built-in ambiance, you know what I'm saying? Let's see. The 35-year-old receptionist came from walking her dog to find a medium-sized puddle of blood on the floor while a red stream trickled down the wall. A video shared with the Post showed. A foul stench flooded the room. I don't know what's in the ceiling. I don't know what I'm breathing in, said the irate tenant. Parker called the police, who found her 56-year-old neighbor's lifeless body upstairs. The chief medical examiner's office ruled the man died from natural causes, although police told Parker's former gay pal they estimated he had been dead for about 3 or 4 days, and his dog had started to eat the corpse. Yeah, I'm not going to New York. I sure as hell don't want to live there. It's already traumatizing to me, said the ex. What? A 36-year-old? Oh. What? Oh, the ex. Okay. 36-year-old plumber. I have high anxiety from this, and I am not living there 24/7. Getting the body out of the building was a quick process, but getting the blood out of Parker's apartment proceeded at a deathly slow pace. Oh, man, that's bad. Property owners are responsible for cleaning up any bodily fluids from accidents per the City Department of Health. Yet, until the Post reached out this week to the building landlord, the controversial developer Genesis Companies, and property manager Concord Management in New York, no one had sent a professional to sanitize Parker's apartment. Ooh. An hour after workers finally came to remove the bloodied light fixture and clean up the stained wall on Thursday, Parker's apartment inexplicably began flooding from the ceiling in the living room, bathroom, and foyer, requiring a second visit for repairs. When does it end? She asked in a video. A Genesis spokesperson said that the building's property manager had been coordinating with the NYPD to gain access to the upstairs apartment that authorities sealed off following the neighbor's death. Both apartments were decontaminated, cleaned, and repaired. We offer our condolences to the family of the deceased and regret any inconvenience for Miss Parker, the spokesperson said, adding that the company offered to put her up in a hotel during renovations. Genesis, which specializes in developing and operating mixed-income residential buildings, has previously been involved in over 100 housing court cases and racked up hundreds of building violations. In 2017, it hired former Lieutenant Governor Brian Benjamin, then a state senator and former Genesis top exec, for a $60,000 a year advisory role. October's horror show is just the latest plague to afflict Parker in her home of roughly 7 years. Her one-bedroom unit, for which she pays $900 a month and snagged in an affordable housing lottery, has been flooded multiple times, with gallons of murky water pouring from the ceiling and down the bathroom walls. A former tenant also held raucous drug parties, drawing junkies who often were found keeled over in the stairwell or incinerator room. You know what the saying is, you get what you paid for, and Parker said, but nobody should have to go through this. Concord did not immediately respond to the request for comment. Those little vampires are still doing what they can. Oy. So, yeah, we'll save this one for the next one, then we'll, yeah, that sounds like fun, so let's do this. That's not the one, that's the one. All right, that is mine. The Asylum, Your Refuge in a World Gone Mad, should be back right after all these messages, whether they are accurate, current, or not, we will find out in just a moment, so don't go nowhere.
Hello, I'm Matt Bennett with WWAY News. Today is Veterans Day, and here are some of the events happening in our area. UNCW's Office of Military Affairs will be hosting its Veterans Day ceremony this morning. The annual event celebrates veterans and military-affiliated students and families. It will be in the lobby of Veterans Hall at 10:45. All students, staff, and faculty are invited. Cape Fear Community College's Division of Veterans Services will also hold a ceremony to honor military veterans today. That's happening at 11 a.m. behind the L and G buildings. In the event of inclement weather, organizers say the ceremony will take place in Union Station, Room 170. Due to anticipated rainy weather, the Veterans Day event in Southport has been moved to the Fire Department headquarters. That event is happening at 2 o'clock this afternoon. Boy Scout Troop 296 will hold a Veterans Day flag retirement ceremony at 11 a.m. That is happening behind the Family Life Center of Northside Church, 2501 North College Road in Wilmington. Everyone is invited. The New Hanover County District Attorney's Office has a new prosecutor position that will focus on gang violence cases. The new role comes after commissioners approved a grant for the DA's office to add that position. Assistant District Attorney Brad Matthews will be stepping into the new role. Currently, he is on the drug team in the DA's office, but in his new position, he will work specifically on cases that involve active gang members and work closely with task forces, the U.S. Attorney's Office, and several law enforcement agencies. District Attorney Ben David believes the new position will help address people's fear of retaliation when reporting gang-related crimes. He also hopes it will deter gang members from committing crimes in the first place. For more on any of these stories, including additional Veterans Day events and cancellations or postponements, you can head over to our website at WWAYTV3.com. I'm Matt Bennett. Have a great day.
Happy Monday, everybody. I'm WWAY meteorologist Ramel Carpenter with the Storm Track 3 forecast. Another chilly one here in the Cape Fear, but a bit warmer compared to our Sunday. I'm expecting a bit more sunshine in the Cape Fear as well, allowing our temperatures to warm up into the upper 50s and the lower 60s for coastal and inland communities. So our temperatures still running about 6 or 7 degrees below the average. But as we head towards the overnight hours tonight, temperatures fall down into the low to middle 40s away from the coast, middle and upper 40s along the immediate coastline. Get your full forecast on WWAY and WWAYTV3.com.
This news and weather is brought to you by Two Men and a Truck. For your free quote, go to twomenandatruck.com. Twomenandatruck.com.
If you're enjoying the content you find on Big Talker, any of your shows, all the hosts, you really need to make sure you're following and liking us on Facebook. There's a video section. You can watch all the live video of programs as they happen. You can also see video of past content that you may have missed for whatever reason. Plus, even better, you can share it with a friend. Let other people know how much you enjoy the Big Talker and the great content we provide and interact with other listeners and the hosts in the comment section live as it happens. Big Talker Net on Facebook.
Are you nervous about joining a gym? Anxious about not being able to keep up with others in the fitness classes? Full Circle Fitness has your solution. We specialize in working with those just getting started on their fitness journey. Our coaches tailor each workout to you and your level of ability so you don't have to worry about keeping up. There's no better opportunity to get started. Call today Full Circle Fitness 910-399-8350 or visit fullcirclefitnessnc.com.
Folks, you know you're all looking for that special gift. Lines are long, traffic is frustrating, supply chains in the news. Just take a deep breath. If you're anywhere near Oak Island, come by Seaside Jewelers, 8801 East Oak Island Drive. Avoid the traffic, the lines, the frustration, and get that extraordinary and special gift. From high-end diamond rings to Larimar, from necklaces to bracelets, watches, and unique jewelry, and you also get one-on-one service with their experienced staff. Great prices now, just in time for the holidays. Come by and check out Seaside Jewelers, 8801 East Oak Island Drive.
It seems like every other store is now selling CBD in some form or another. But did you know that Wilmington has just one local CBD company? I'm talking about Carolina Pure. Family owned and operated, they are Wilmington's first and only CBD company that makes quality hemp products right here in town, including tinctures, topicals, and pet products. Their hemp is sourced from local farmers and they support area musicians and nonprofits. Check us out at CarolinaPureShop.com.
Hope Abounds, North Carolina's premier cancer support network, invites you to attend our Gift of Hope by Giving to Others event on Saturday, November 12th at 6 p.m. at the Wrightsville Beach Holiday Inn Resort, with music provided by Ray Kennedy and the Opera House Theater Company. So join us for an evening of food, music, hope, information, a live auction, and more, while supporting the hard work of the Hope Abounds Cancer Network. For more information, please call us at 910-799-7178 or visit us online at hopeabounds.org.
The left has hijacked our media, our culture, and our schools. Your children are taught to hate America. Your speech is censored. Your employer is woke, and you are being called racist. That's why I wrote a book showing you how to keep the left from dominating your life. The book is called Rules for Anti-Radicals, A Practical Handbook for Defeating Leftism. And it draws from my 28 years of grassroots leadership by empowering conservatives too often bullied into silence by the left. It's a comprehensive guide to beating leftism not only in politics, but in daily life. And it's not just for dedicated conservative activists, but also for anyone sick of getting beaten down by the woke mob. Whether it's your job, your school board, or your neighbors, you can win against woke. Get Rules for Anti-Radicals from Amazon or at rulesforantiradicals.com/radio. That's rulesforantiradicals.com/radio.
Welcome back to News Time. Your refuge in the world gone mad right here on the Big Talker Network. BigTalker.live is the website where you can download the app for the Android and or iOS devices, which you can then pair with your automobile's entertainment system so that you can take the Big Talker anywhere and everywhere you have to be, whether you want to be there or not. You can also send an email with any comments, questions, concerns, compliments, or critiques you may have. We cannot be your community radio station without your feedback. So come on, get brave, write an email. Tell us how good or bad we're doing. I promise we won't get mad. I promise we won't get mad. I'm going to continue on this story we had a little bit earlier of the 50-year-old man who smokes like I do. I'm guessing as well, maybe he's just 50, but, you know, yeah, they show him running down the road with a cigarette. He's even saluting while he runs. let's see, where were we? Unfortunately, not much is known about the man apart from the fact he is known as Uncle Chen among fellow runners, who also confirmed his habit of smoking while running. According to anecdotal reports on social media, Uncle Chen has been spotted at other marathons in the last few years, including the Witchamandoodaloom and the other ones. After some photos of the man smoking and running, the organizers of the marathon also shared a certificate of achievement, which not only proved he took part in the event, but also that he ran the 42.195 kilometers in a respectable 3.5 hours, more or less. You know, 3 hours, 28 minutes, 45 seconds, ranking 515th out of thousands of runners. Once the story went viral, photos of Uncle Chen smoking while running the 2018 Guangzhou Marathon also surfaced online, and runners attested to having spotted him at events in 2019 as well. Running is good for your health. Smoking is bad for your health. Do they cancel each other out? One person asked in a comment, while another wondered whether Uncle Chen smokes during marathons because nicotine acts as a stimulant. I think it's fair to say there are better suited stimulants available, like meth. Anyway, smoking is no joke, though, and you don't have to take my word for it. Just as the COPD athlete, and then it just stops. Because they don't write very well over at Otter D Central, just so you know. Now, here's one I thought was a little more American than most. Coming out of WTAE Pittsburgh's Action 4 News. This story covered by Sheldon Ingram, man arrested after taking back his car from McKeesport Repossession Company. An employee says the man threw her to the ground while trying to bring the car into the garage. McKeesport, Pennsylvania. A man has been arrested after trying to take back his repossessed car in McKeesport Friday afternoon. What Friday is this? Would see updated November 13. So yeah, there we go. Ramond Tyrone Dallas, 25, of Wilkinsburg, is being charged with car theft, trespassing, assault, resisting arrest, and several other charges, according to the criminal complaint. Employees at American Recovery on Lysel Boulevard say a man climbed the fence to get onto the property and take back the car. After he was on the property, they say he got into the car and pulled out an employee who was trying to put it in the garage. Melanie Pierce says, the man threw me on the ground when I was trying to keep him from taking his car. She was in the driver's seat at the time and said he was trying to put his car in the garage so he couldn't take it. I was trying to put his car in the garage so that he couldn't take it. Employees say the man drove off and was later caught by police. Video of the arrest was taken right outside Founders Hall Middle School. In the video, police cruisers surround the man in the repossessed car. He then tries to run away up the school's hill with police chasing after him. They eventually caught up with him and took him into custody. Pittsburgh's Action 4 News is still waiting to hear from police about this incident. I think he pretty much spelled it out right there. The man's trying to get his car back. Oh, here's something disgusting. Bob Dylan's teenage love letters are up for sale in case you're interested. Just thought you might want to know that. And in our last episode or last installment of Stupid Human Tricks. Oh, my God. Oh, man. People, y'all are just annoying as hell. A woman, I guess, spooky, coming from Oddity Central. Yeah, why not? Woman allegedly wires her own mouth shut to lose weight. Woohoo! Yeah, how far can we go with this one? A South African woman allegedly wired her mouth shut with slimming wires in a desperate attempt to lose weight for a breast reduction surgery. I think there's other ways you could go about this. I'm gonna butcher this name. Aviwe Mazosiwe has been trying to lose weight and reach a certain BMI to qualify for breast reduction surgery that she hopes will improve her quality of life. She has managed to lose 12 kilograms with intermittent fasting, but after reaching a plateau on her weight loss journey, the South African woman decided to take more drastic measures. In June of this year, she had slimming wires fitted on her teeth. These are orthodontic brackets with wires wrapped through them that are attached to the wearer's teeth to keep the jaw shut. It's a controversial weight loss device that has attracted a lot of criticism online after Aviwe started sharing her experience on TikTok. This is why TikTok is just a bad idea. I had so many negative comments, but I can't remember them all because I tried my best not to focus on those, Aviwe told British tabloid The Sun. I was still very new to the app itself when I started sharing my journey, and the negative comments made me want to shut down the whole thing, she added. But I decided to keep going because it somehow felt like something I needed to share. Besides, the good comments made up for all the negativity. See, Aviwe had the slimming wires installed at the end of June and kept them on for 7 weeks, during which time she lost a whopping 14.3 kilograms. Because her jaw was wired shut, she relied on liquid foods like smoothies, soups, and yogurt for sustenance, and claims that the savory taste of the soup kept her cravings in check. After having the slimming wires removed, the woman did indulge in one guilty pleasure, a jalapeno burger from her favorite place, but she did have to wait a day because her jaw muscles needed time to adjust after 7 weeks of being stuck in the same position. Her quote continues out of absolute brilliance here. quote, I get that it's a bit extreme, but it really helped me as I struggled with self-discipline and sticking to clean eating over a long period. Abiwe explained, adding that she understands slimming wires are not for everyone. Only do this when you're ready and in good space mentally, especially if you're an emotional eater, she said. These slimming wires reminded us about a very similar and equally controversial weight loss device we featured last year on Oddity Central, the Dental Slim Diet Control. It was designed to allow wearers to open their mouths only about 2 millimeters, thus making them unable to chew while making breathing and speaking possible. A quick Google search revealed that Aviwe's story is not uncommon. Apparently, slimming wires are very popular in South Africa, and there are hundreds of videos on YouTube by people documenting their experiences. Now, as far as documenting your experience, there is one movie I would like to talk about that I saw at Cucalorus. One of the things about Cucalorus, if you catch a film, you're going to catch something you would not normally see. Not out there in the big world. The movie was called Jack Has a Plan. And if you Google it, whatever you got to do to find this movie. Because there's some controversy involved. The man was diagnosed with a brain tumor and was in surgery about a month after he got married. I mean, that's how quick the decline began. And they carved out a huge section of his brain. And he did pretty, you know, they gave him like 6 months. You know, dude, just put your affair in order, pay off your bills, and, you know, pick you a spot. And he continued for another 20 years or so and asked one of his friends, somebody I got to meet, the producer whom I got to meet last night. Was it last night? I think it was. He had a plan. And his plan was basically to document not only his condition during decline or in decline, but also his choice to say when he's had enough. Yep, not assisted suicide, but basically the, you know, right to a dignified end of life. He knows what's coming. The man was being blinded day by day. Sometimes one eye would close and just not open. Some days both eyes would just no longer send data to his brain. And then the next day, you know, for a couple hours, he might be absolutely fine. It had to be, you know, if you watch the movie, you realize how much of a mind screw it is that this guy was, you know, it's his decision, it's his life. As far as autonomy over bodily awareness, you know, your own body, whether you're a man, a woman, somewhere in between, undecided, whatever. Autonomy over your own body is like the one freedom that we, you know, as the director, I think it was director, producer had stated that, you know, in a country that values freedom, we really don't have the freedom over our own bodies, whether male or female or otherwise. And in this case, the man knows that he would rather not die as a declined, completely pain in the ass burden on everybody and everything around him. I mean, one of his things was, you know, was like when explaining, because they documented so much about what he was doing, not only where he'd been, where he'd come from. He was an artist, a musician, a performer, a creative. And one of the discussions was, look, I don't want to live if my quality of life requires other people to wipe my butt. I mean, think of it. We may speak of this in joking terms or in some sort of casual conversation with you know, some sort of comedic edge to it or something. And it was very real for this man. Right? One of the documents, they'd gone out to lunch, you know, the filmmaker, he's just, you know, using whatever he has to make a film to shoot this scene in a diner. And he had a seizure right there in the restaurant. But it wasn't like a grand mal that we all think of as a seizure, but it was a brain seizure where he just turned off for about 5 or 6 minutes. He could not respond to any language, spoken or otherwise, because he just did not have that cognitive connection at that time. Another time he has a seizure and his eye just goes blah. And suddenly he cannot see out of one eye, just completely turned off. And it took it all the way to the end where, after the decision, the day of, I mean, they document in more detail the last 4 or 5 days before his appointment with God. And the day of, they basically had a little brunch party, you know, catered food, friends and family, all of them, every last one of them, trying to convince him to hang on, to, you know, you're fine. He's not fine. His cognitive decline and the pain that he was experiencing is something that cannot be empathized by someone else until it, you know, it's one of those things you cannot understand until it happens to you. And I have a family member on the other side of that same decision. In this man's case, in Jack's case, he's saying, you know what? My life. I'm not doing chemo. I want the quality of my life. I want the pain in my life to be as minimal, you know, that I'm not doing this for anybody else. I'm doing this for me. It was basically his thing. My decision, my body, my choice. Which is a mantra that we've been, you know, spouting in this country for a while, and nobody seems to be listening or respecting that freedom. So at 4 o'clock on a Friday afternoon, he drank a little cocktail and commented just before he fell asleep to his wife, "It didn't taste as bad as I thought it would." The rest of the movie is in complete silence, other than the music composition behind it, showing scenes of the medical examiner who had already been notified that there was going to be a dead body in this hotel, or excuse me, in this apartment. So there's no special event. There was no investigation. Everything was already cool and on the up and up. And they wheeled his body out, cremated it, and they spooned it into individual containers for the friends and family to share one last time. That's a type of bravery that's unparalleled, I think. To stand up against his family and his friends, his own wife. An unpopular decision among all of them. It's not fair, it's not fair, was one of the themes of the argument. He says, how is this fair? How is it fair for me to endure this level of pain and absolute embarrassment, right? Incontinence and seizures and going blind and the inability to speak. The inability to comprehend, the inability to recognize faces, you know, whether it's 5 minutes or 5 hours, it's still, you know, it's happening to this man. And he had said, I know this is not going to end well, and I want to die at home, not in a hospital, surrounded by smocks and masks and people I don't know. A very unpopular decision, but one that left him with peace and dignity at the end. Movies like that, you're not going to see in, you know, in your Avengers block or, you know, some, whatever it is that makes popular movies making millions of dollars for the industry, you know, for the whatever screen company made that film. This man was asked directly by his friend. And the turning point is what killed me. Because when he was asked by Jack to do this film, he didn't want to. I mean, would you? And he kind of blew him off, you know, like, yeah, we'll do it next year, we'll do it next year. And the man managed to survive past the 6 months the doctors gave him. I mean, it was another 2.5 decades that he's still trying to live and work, and eventually had to give up his job because he just couldn't do it anymore. His brain just would not allow him to function in the capacity necessary for him to maintain an income. And he had asked his friend, document me. He didn't want to. I can get that. Put him off for a year or two, several years, 10 years. And then one day he called him back up and said, look, we should at least talk. Handed him the keys to his storage unit. And the producer walked in, you know, unlocked it. They document him going in, having seen this stuff for the first time. Piles of his history. Videotapes of you know, projects he had worked on 20 years, 30 years earlier. Music, art, his picture books, you know, photo albums from 20, 30 years previous. And it wasn't until he got into those boxes did the producer say, yeah, this needs to happen. Oh, it hurt. It really hurt. Because I would wish for anybody who's in a terminal format, terminal situation, to be allowed the dignity of their own decision, knowing that their end-of-life choices are usually limited to being told when and where they are going to die in some random hospital room or hospice or something, as opposed to being able to say, you know what, my choice, my time. For Jack, it was Friday at 4 p.m. And it also showed how difficult it was for the family and friends. Right? 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you're having a catered lunch with your friend in his apartment. And at about 10 till 4, quarter to 4, everybody's given a big hug and sent out the door so that it's just him and his wife. He endured that for 25 years. And the battle over his decision for at least 2 or 3 years, completely inundated from his family and in-laws and friends and everybody. I can't believe you're doing this. I can't believe you're doing this. I can't believe you're doing this. Yeah, well, you can't believe what it is I go through. What it, you know, was one of the paraphrased responses. This is my pain. This is my life. This is my choice. If we can't extend a simple freedom like that, how the hell are we going to handle stupid stuff like abortion? Not your choice. How are we going to handle horrible situations when it happens to other people? It's unfair to try and legislate what a person can and cannot do with their own pain, with their own life. Which I find just hilarious in a macabre way that suicide is illegal. But how are you going to prosecute attempted suicide as a, you know, put someone in jail for, we're just not wrapped tight. We just celebrated 8 billion people on the planet. At some point, the planet just cannot support this. And we ourselves can't even, you know, recognize the value of life unless it's a life attached to us in some way, whether by marriage or by blood. It'll never be important to the powerful people until it happens to them. Right? I think that was pointed out in one of the Iron Mans, in Iron Man 3, where the guy was, I don't know if it was a president or one of those guys whose own daughter had been afflicted by this limb-changing thing and was giving this guy money. It's backwards. And then when it is important to somebody important, then they can pull all kinds of strings and pull off all kinds of heinous, nasty, illegal, horrible, heinous stuff in the interest of their own interest, of their own family, of their own importance. We can't seem to do this as a group. We can't seem to understand one person to another. The latest example of that would be what happened in Colorado. Just because you don't agree doesn't give you any right or reason to kill anyone else. But we just can't seem to figure that out. We're a pretty stupid lot, it seems. So that's not really helping us get into the mood for Thanksgiving this year, but I'm emotionally raw from a week of insanely good movies that were bold, brilliant, beautiful, and brutal. Every last one of them. Amazing. So if you haven't been touched by that, you should be. At some point, I don't know. That's just me. So with that in mind, we are going to close down the asylum for today, and we will see you tomorrow right here on the Big Talker. Tuning in is totally up to you. And we'll see you then. Take care.